What should we be doing? Now, let's talk about some things that people are not talking about. Good day, and welcome to this edition of the Wise Medical Minute. Now, I would like to make it possible for you to understand me. So even though I am an advocate for wearing these masks, I'm going to come out of the mask for purposes of this video because there's nobody within 6 feet of me. Now, I'm advocating custom-made University of Georgia masks, but we can do it with any school you want to promote. But more importantly, if you're really trying to prevent infection, you need an N95 mask. But for purposes of communicating, I'm going to get rid of all the masks. But we'll get back to talking about masks in a minute. I do believe there's a place for them, and I'll spend some time clarifying what's good, what's bad, what's needed, what's not. But in our previous videos, we stressed conversation about reducing the anxiety and reducing the fear associated with the coronavirus. COVID-19, as it's been called, that's important to recognize. There's lots of coronaviruses out there, but we're specifically limiting our conversation today about COVID-19, it has been dubbed. Now, as of this morning, approaching 3 million people, according to official reports, have been diagnosed to have this condition. And something less than 0.4%, i.e. 140,000 people, have died. That is not a trivial number. That is serious. That is a number we cannot disrespect. However, 99 point something people still haven't been affected. And I predict that number will just continue to grow for several reasons. The main reason being they've deliberately made it difficult to accurately test people, and they've deliberately tried to keep the numbers low by limiting access to testing. I've referred people for various tests recently, and they've had to wait in line in automobiles for 8 hours before they could get tested. That's ridiculous. The good news is we do have screening tests available, and we'll get back to that in a minute. But I point out that these numbers are all but meaningless, but they're continuing to grow, and I predict they'll grow exponentially if what the experts tell us is true. But I want to keep it in perspective. Even with 140,000 people dead, even with 3 million people having been affected, we're still looking at something slightly less than 1% of the U.S. population. But having begun testing in our own practice, I know those numbers are ridiculously low, because we have started doing the antibody testing and people are coming out of the woodwork, and our numbers are approaching 20% of the tests we do are turning up positive. But we'll get back to that a little bit more in a moment. So the real purpose of this video is, what should we be doing? Okay, we've heard a lot about the hand washing, very important. We've heard a lot about wearing a mask, very important. We've heard a lot about social distancing. So I won't preach more about those things, but I will talk about the importance of sanitizing surfaces. That matters a lot. Door handles, tabletops, any frequently touched objects. We spend as much energy sanitizing those with whichever disinfectant, and that has as important a role, I believe, as the hand washing and wearing the mask. Let's talk about the masks, because the pendulum has swung back and forth, but I want people to understand that it's become almost a courtesy. It's a social thing now. It's a way to show mutual respect. If you wear a mask, you're telling people, I'm not going to give you my germs. But I don't think we should be reasonably confident that wearing a mask is going to prevent you from getting infected. So the social distancing is as important as the mask, and which mask matters. The so-called N95 does prevent more of the smaller particles like viruses and dust compared to the regular surgical mask. But if you are ill, or if you don't know you are ill, the regular surgical masks or cloth coverings will keep you from giving somebody else a viral infection. So it's as much about protecting other people as it is about protecting yourself. So the mask plays that vital role. Now let's talk about some things that people are not talking about. Stress, sweating over all these little impositions caused by our being forced to be in quarantine. Stress increases the likelihood that you're gonna catch something. Reducing stress improves your immunity. So we need to stop worrying and obsessing over things, because that actually increases the likelihood that you're gonna get sick. So when you feel stressed out, take a deep breath, rest, and equally importantly, get enough sleep. All these kinds of things are helpful as far as improving your immunity. Now, exercise does make a difference. We want to use exercise as a way to stay healthy. But most of what exercise does is kind of indirect, but it's good for you anyway, even if it has nothing to do with this infection. I did read a passage recently about wearing masks while exercising. I want to comment on that further when I get some hard data that makes sense. But I think the benefits of exercise outweigh the risks associated with taking your mask off while you're exercising, if you're keeping your social distancing in place at the same time. Exercise outside is less risky than exercise inside. So let's keep that in mind as well. I do want to encourage the exercise, A, as a means of general health, but B, enhancing your immunity and helping you to ward off the virus if you do get it. Now, sunlight. Getting outside is good. Being in a crowd of people outside is not necessarily good. There's some positive effects on vitamin D that's good for our immunity. So I won't belabor that point now, but suffice it to say, sunlight is good. It enhances immunity, and I don't think people are talking about that enough. Now, here's another issue that people are not talking about enough. Don't drink. Alcohol, as well as other illicit drugs, has a compromising effect on your immunity. So we could talk about drinking in terms of how much is too much, but when you use what the CDC calls excessive amounts of alcohol, it has killed 88,000 people in the last year for which we have available data. Now, if you look at the percentage of people who die from alcohol and the percentage of the population that drinks, the percent of people dying from alcohol is higher than the percent of people dying from this virus. So that could be a whole nother video. But the point is, relevant to the COVID-19, alcohol does compromise your immunity. So I'll not miss the opportunity to emphasize that's another thing we should be done. So I don't know why there's so much emphasis on opening up bars when we're trying to prevent infection. It's just politics and economics and not science and not medically logical. Let's get back to testing. Now, most of the tests that are available readily with immediate results are the antibody tests. We've just recently started doing it in our practice, and I think it has a useful place. However, we need to know the limitations of the antibody testing. The antibody test is convenient. The antibody test has improved. Some of them, I want to mention one in particular, have an unacceptably high false negative rate, the Abbott test that was being promoted by Walgreens. I noticed they shut them down recently. But we were able to be blessed to get a test that was manufactured overseas. It was approved by the EU. It was approved by the Chinese FDA, and it's been at least cleared, and according to the distributor, approved by the FDA for this country. I have to verify that. But suffice it to say, it's extremely sensitive. I'm a bit worried about false positives with this test, because we're picking up more than 25% of the people we test, most of whom have no symptoms, are actually turning out to be positive. But here's where the value of the antibody test comes in. The antibody test that we use has both IgM and IgG as the antibodies that are being tested. IgM at least tells you that your exposure was relatively recent. IgG at least indicates that it was a little while ago, at least days, probably weeks. And what we hope is down the road, the presence of IgG may have implications about immunity. Now, we have a document on when it's safe to return to work. And I'm going to do a whole separate video on that with the antibody testing as a guide. But that's going to be the basis for our next video. As soon as I have our own hard data, we should have statistically significant data pretty soon. But the point I want to make for right now is when someone tests positive, it's necessary to do some kind of contact tracing. Now, we're obligated to report people to the state health department when we get a positive test, and we've begun to do that. But I believe periodic testing is the emphasis that I want to stress. Just because you're negative today doesn't mean you can't go out and get exposed tomorrow. And therefore, interval testing at what interval to be determined. But I'm thinking weekly or monthly is somewhere in between is reasonable, but it depends on your activity level. If you've been around people that have been careless and not wearing masks, or if you've been around people especially who were sick, obviously you want to be tested more frequently than if you've been sheltering in place. So periodic testing is not discussed enough, but one negative test doesn't mean you need to not be tested anymore. Especially if we're going to talk about getting back to normal when it comes to things like school, church, synagogue, whatever. But one negative test should not be the end of the conversation. What about if it's positive? When the antibody test is positive, that's not enough information to say you're not infectious. Okay, whether or not you can give the virus to someone needs to be further determined by the so-called PCR test, which checks for the viral proteins and various things that are beyond the scope of this video. But there's a better test that is not as widely available as it should be that tests for whether you're infectious or not. There are guidelines based on the antibody tests about when you shouldn't be infectious. But the only way to verify that is with the so-called PCR test that tests for the actual viral proteins. So we're going to do more about testing and returning to work in a future video. But let's talk about treatment. Now, I have not taken a position on this hydroxychloroquine yet. The data that's supporting hydroxychloroquine is impressive, but anecdotal. The hard data is not very supportive of using hydroxychloroquine as a treatment. The bias that is behind that data is what makes me still talk about it. The people who are developing drugs that they're gonna charge you an arm and a leg for are also generating the data that says hydroxychloroquine is not good for you. So I question it just on that basis because there's anecdotal data that's quite to the contrary that I'm not willing to ignore. However, the thing nobody's talking about is if you choose, or if your doctor chooses, to use hydroxychloroquine, there is a possibility of a rare fatal complication that you should be able to prevent or identify whether you are at risk for. A simple electrocardiogram before you take hydroxychloroquine will identify whether you have something known as a prolonged QT interval. And that's not a hard diagnosis to make. When a person has a prolonged QT interval, or if they develop a prolonged QT interval while they're on hydroxychloroquine or other drugs, that's when you need to stop it. The risks are not justified. As for the other treatments, combining hydroxychloroquine with zinc, combining it with azithromycin or the other mycins, all that's got a place, but that's a discussion beyond the scope of this video. But if you do use the hydroxychloroquine, understand that a reasonable precaution is to look at an EKG, see if you're at risk for the cardiac arrhythmias that could kill you. In the absence of that, you know, it's a judgment call. I don't think there's a correct answer yet. Now, I definitely will say that the data is convincing enough that using hydroxychloroquine so-called prophylactically to prevent infection is not justified. It's a change in my previous posture, so I wanted to make sure I made that point. Now let's talk about being practical, okay? Human beings weren't made to be quarantined, you know. We need to be able to get along with our lives and function in society. And you have to understand that people don't get this infection by going to the grocery store. Now, the people who work in the grocery store, by being exposed to so many people in the general public, they are at increased risk. But most people actually get infected from contact within their own household. When their family member has a risky job, or their family member is careless and not wearing masks when they're out partying, you know, they bring it home and they infect people in their own household. So if someone's been exposed at work or somebody's been exposed while socializing, those folks will bring it home, and that's where you're gonna be most likely to get infected. The idea is sustained, continuous contact is where the risk of infection is greatest. Now, when family members have been exposed, it's perfectly reasonable to shelter in place together, because chances are everybody else has been exposed already. And it's more important to be focused on enhancing immunity. If you can separate yourself from the family members who are not sick, do it. But the idea is, don't go out and spread the virus to people who haven't been exposed. But if you've been exposed as a group, let that group shelter in place together. Now, I want to take a proactive and I think preemptive posture when it comes to vaccines. My biggest fear is the same politics and the same economically motivated policy making decisions will make it difficult for us to get vaccines when one is available. Now, under the guise of talking about safety, they're gonna have issues with making stuff available where the parties, the powers that be, you know, will benefit economically. So you may need to be prepared to travel. When another country comes up with a vaccine, we may have to get an airplane ticket instead of a doctor's office appointment to get properly vaccinated. Now, the anti-vaccine lobby has already started digging in. And the thing I want people to understand is all of the vaccines that are being developed to produce antibodies against critical viral proteins. They're not trying to make any more live attenuated vaccines. In the past, vaccines were made by making the actual virus weak and exposing people to the weakened virus with the expectation that they would get immune and therefore not get sick. Sometimes those weakened viruses actually cause disease. But they've been smart enough that with the vaccines that are in development, nobody's using live attenuated viruses. So when one comes out, it's probably gonna be safe and a lot less risky to use the vaccine than to risk dying from COVID-19 infection. So let's preempt some of the anti-vaccine nonsense and let's be prepared to circumvent our government if they're as unreasonable about the vaccines as they have been about the testing. And we may have to do what we have to do to prevent people from getting infected. Safety does matter, so we don't want to be reckless in terms of just trying anything that somebody comes up with. But if it's been approved by other authorities, less political than the FDA, give it some credence. A lot of times, good treatments may be delayed for political and economic reasons, and we got people to worry about. We got lives to save. You know, we can't, you know, worry about whether it's a Republican or a Democrat that developed the stupid vaccine. But we need to get out from behind all that kind of posturing that gets people killed. The most reassuring fact that I want to leave everyone with is that we all probably will eventually get this thing if we don't get vaccinated. But the good news is the vast majority, more than 95% of people, will completely recover. And only a small percentage, as of now, you know, 0.4% of people will die. But this risk is much greater if you're older, if you have pre-existing conditions. We've talked about that in previous videos. I urge you to look at those and subscribe to our channel so that you can get a more complete and comprehensive picture about this. But if you are infected and if you do become seriously ill, you will need prompt attention at a hospital where proper services are available to give you the support that you need. There's no definitive treatment, but the supportive treatment saves lives. And most hospitals have gotten enough experience with it that people aren't dying at the same rate that they were previously. But this virus must be taken seriously, but I don't think that a lot of the panic and fear and the anxiety are necessary. The anxiety and the fear will kill more people than the virus. So understand what's going on, use common sense, and as always, we'll make wise choices. Thank you for your attention, and I look forward to the next edition of the Wise Medical Minute.
Thank you for listening to the Wise Medical Minute with Dr. Thomas Locke. Dr. Locke addresses current events as well as important medical issues using responsible, unbiased journalism approached from a medical perspective. We invite you to submit questions or comments or suggestions for future topics by email to info@wisemedicalcenter.com. Again, thank you for viewing the Wise Medical Minute.